From 1993 to 2005, three women lost their lives to this vicious monster. Michael Gargiulo started in his hometown, Glenview, Illinois, near Chicago in 1993. The 17-year-old ambushed his friend's older sister just after midnight as she opened her front door. He went berserk, stabbing her at least a dozen times. While DNA was found at the scene, the technology of the day was not able to match it to Gargiulo at the time. He moved to LA a few years later to pursue a career as an actor and model. But the rage and hate continued to build in Gargiulo, and he would commit two more homicides, including that of Ashton Kutcher's girlfriend, before police were finally able to obtain critical evidence from a surviving victim. His DNA would also eventually link him to the 1993 slaying in Illinois. The savagery and evil of the attacks would lead Michael Gargiulo to be given the ominous nickname, the Hollywood Ripper. I hate to ask, but if you could hit the like button and leave a comment, even if it's just to say, it would really help the channel grow and fuel Al Gore's rhythm. Michael Gargiulo was born on February 15, 1976, and grew up in Glenville, Illinois. He had six siblings, and from an early age, Michael had a temper and was known as a bully in his neighborhood. Perhaps this was in part due to the physical mistreatment he reports suffering at the hands of his father. One of his friends, Doug Boccaccio, lived three doors down, and in 1993, when Michael was 17, there was a horrific crime at their home. On August 13th, Trisha Boccaccio was enjoying the last nights with her friends before heading off to college at Purdue University. The 18-year-old was just getting home after dropping off her friends just after midnight, but she would never get into the house. The next morning, her dad was taking the dog for a walk when he found her in a bloody heap just outside the door. At the time, it was unknown who her attacker was, but the assault had been brutal. Trisha's left arm had been twisted back to the point that it broke, and a knife had been plunged into her at least a dozen times. Several vital organs had been damaged, and the scene was drenched in blood. There was one clue to the identity of her attacker. An autopsy would find skin under Trisha's fingernails, though at the time, there was no one to test it against. Police questioned anyone who might be involved or know something about the case, so naturally, they brought in Michael. He had given Trisha a ride home just a few days before the crime and come to see the crime scene with other neighbors gawking at the swarm of police. Suspicions intensified when Michael began bringing gifts to the Boccaccios. They knew him well as he had spent a lot of time with their son. And not long after they lost their daughter, he started stopping by to see them. First to bring flowers, then clothes and gift certificates. All this made police want to take another look at Michael, but he knew how to throw them off his trail. He pointed them at another boy in the neighborhood, Eric Agazim. Michael told police that Eric had come to ask him to help hide a duffel bag and inferred that there was a bloody knife inside. When authorities approached Eric, he refused to give an interview, which effectively ended the investigation into Michael and made Eric the number one suspect. Though there was no evidence tying Eric to the crime, and so the investigation hit a wall. Meanwhile, the true perpetrator continued committing crimes in the area. Michael had run-ins with the law over theft after he was caught rooting through unlocked cars, as well as an arrest for assault. In 1998, Michael again visited the Boccaccios. This time, it seemed he had something important to tell them. But before he could say anything, his dad and sister came and pulled him away. But this experience was enough for Trisha's dad to call police and tell them that he believed Michael was behind the heinous crime. But the Gargiulos were not going to wait around for investigators to find more evidence against Michael, and he moved to California with dreams of becoming a celebrity. He got some small acting parts, but those who knew him remember him more for the strange and worrying statements that he made. While working as a bouncer at the Rainbow Bar and Grill, he asked his coworkers if they had ever taken a life, and said that he had. However, they wrote this off as a lie to make him seem tougher than he actually was. Michael would lose his job as a bouncer after punching a customer and move on to become an HVAC repairman, giving him access to a huge number of people's homes. In this capacity, he met several people who moved in celebrity circles. One such person was Ashley Ellerin. She was a promising fashion student who was dating Ashton Kutcher. Friends would report seeing Michael outside her home at odd hours, but assumed that he was just strange and harmless. This would change on February 21st, 2001. Ashley had plans to attend a Grammy party with Ashton, but when he arrived to pick her up just after 11 p.m., she did not answer the door. Through the window, he saw a pool of what he assumed was spilled wine, and for whatever reason, did not investigate further. The next morning, one of Ashley's roommates arrived home and found a horrific scene. The young woman had been stabbed almost 50 times, and her head had nearly been severed from the ferocity of the attack. Friends would tell police about the strange man who had been hanging around, who they called Mike the Furnace Repairman. Meanwhile, in Illinois, police were retesting the DNA evidence found under Trisha's fingernails. They wanted to get samples from all their suspects, and so they flew out to California to track Michael down. They met with local police, and the two agencies realized they were both hunting for the same person for a murder in their respective cities. When they found Gargiulo, he tried to fight the officers, but eventually was forced to give a DNA sample from a hospital emergency room. This is where things get a little sketchy. Michael's DNA were a positive match to that found under Trisha's fingernails, but the DA did not press charges, as he said that the DNA could have been transferred through normal contact during the ride that he had given her, and did not necessarily mean that he had committed the crime. The California police, on the other hand, did not have a DNA sample from the Ellerin crime scene to compare Michael's against, and so the investigation hit a wall. As the years went on, Michael would be accused of stalking other women, but in 2005, he would once again commit a homicide. 32-year-old Maria Bruno lived in the same apartment complex as Michael and his girlfriend. The mother of four had moved in just 10 days before Gargiulo targeted her. On December 1st, 2005, he broke in through her kitchen window and committed a horrifically savage attack. She was found the next morning with her throat slashed and numerous stab wounds. He went a step further in this case and cut flesh from Maria's chest and placed it over her mouth. The only clue in the crime was a surgical shoe slipper found just outside the apartment. Gargiulo used such slippers in his capacity as a heating and air conditioner repairman when going into customers' homes, and apparently used them when committing crimes to minimize the evidence that he left behind. With no clear suspect in the case, the homicide of Bruno would go unsolved. Despite his history of being very close to multiple homicides, Gargiulo was still free to roam in search of victims. He had moved from the apartment next to where he had taken Bruno's life, and into Santa Monica. One of his neighbors soon caught his eye. Michelle Murphy was a 27-year-old that lived across the alley from Michael, and it was found that he had a direct line of sight into her bedroom. On April 28, 2008, Murphy awoke to find a hooded man with a knife rushing at her. She put up a ferocious fight despite her short stature. She was successful in fighting off her attacker after he cut himself with his own knife, leaving behind his DNA. On his way out of the room, she heard her assailant mutter, "I'm sorry." The blood sample left at the scene came back as a match to Gargiulo, and he was soon apprehended. In his car, they found more of the shoe slippers like were found near the Bruno crime scene. He was charged with the attack on Murphy and the homicides of Bruno and Ellerin. Despite all this, it was 3 years before Illinois authorities thought to charge him in the Picaccio case. While incarcerated, Gargiulo did not help himself when an escape plan was exposed. The creature had told other inmates that he would throat punch a guard, then flee. Needless to say, this plan was foiled and gave further evidence to the willingness of Gargiulo to commit violence to get what he wanted. The California court case started in May of 2019. Among the witnesses that testified were Ashton Kutcher and Michelle Murphy. The only defense that Gargiulo's lawyers could come up with was that he had a mental defect and did not recall attacking Murphy or the other victims. This was not successful, and in fall of 2019, he was convicted. After attempting to appeal the conviction, Gargiulo was sentenced to be executed in 2021. However, Governor Newsom has stopped all executions, and so this sentence is unlikely to be carried out. But this is just one of many terrible decisions made by Newsom, who is now trying to run for president, which absolutely should not be a possibility after how California has fared under his leadership. Gargiulo is expected to be extradited to Illinois to stand trial in the Picaccio case. But considering the lackadaisical efforts of the prosecutors so far, this will likely not happen anytime soon.